the three ladies that were supposed to come had to work tonight. And so we had it on Tuesday to get both groups together and didn't end up working out. But I'm glad that you guys are all here. And from now on, though, so there's no confusion, your night still is Thursday nights. And we will meet every other Thursday night. And I do have, I'm getting some, they're like this. I'm having them printed that you can just pass out, but they're not ready yet. I was planning to bring them tonight, but they haven't come yet. And they just have the dates on it for the Bible study nights that we'll be doing it this, you know, until like the end of the, close to the end of the year. And so that way you can pass them out to your friends. It'll have the exact dates on there, the website information and stuff like that. So I thought I'd put that up there, but I don't think I did. Yeah, 9/19 is the next one. So not this coming Thursday, but the next, September 19th. And then I will have those for you guys soon to pass out, and so that you'll. And every time I have a graphic, I will also post it on Facebook and I will email it. How many of you are getting my emails that I send out? They'll have like the blog information and. Okay, cool. If I don't have your information, just make sure that I have it before you leave, or you can go on onething.tv and fill out, like, to join the Bible study. You can fill in that thing, then I'll have your email. It sends it directly to me if you do that, and then you'll get all of the information. And I always post them, so feel free. Would love for you to tag people, send it, share it on your walls or whatever. That's an awesome way, because a lot of people, that's how they find out now, you know, even more than mail. I want to announce the She Conference that's coming up. We're super excited about it. Tina Tatum is coming to speak. I'll be speaking as well, but I'm so excited about Tina coming. She is phenomenal. You will so enjoy her ministry. She called me a couple of weeks ago and just totally spoke into my life from where I am right now, and I've only met her once, and she doesn't know anything. She's like pumped up and ready to go, and she's praying about the conference. And it is September 27th and 28th. We will need you to register online if you haven't already. You can go to the connectionschurch.tv website and register. If you don't want to pay online on that tab, then you need to mark an envelope and mark it as the She Conference for your $20 and get it in so that you can pay $20, because it's $30 at the door. So you can save money by that. And so it's on, yes, it's on sale for the early registration. And that include, you're going to receive, you're going to get a lunch for that as well. It's like a light breakfast and a lunch on Saturday. And that Friday night, we're going to have worship music and everything. We have some people coming in from out of town too to help. And it's just going to be a refreshing time. We just want you to leave refreshed and be able to come and not worry about anything, and just women getting together. And a bunch of women are powerful. You know, I mean, seriously, we're the prayer warriors. We are the guardians of our home. And I'm telling you, we really get things done. And we are, you know, they say behind every great man is a great woman. And I mean, I believe that, because you have power. You have power that you don't even realize, which is some of what we'll be talking about. But this is going to be awesome. So go online and register. We also have, are they up here? Oh, cool. Okay. So if she gave them to you, then you can mail them. You don't have to put them in an envelope if you don't want to. You can just put a stamp on it. But there are some envelopes out there if you need them. So get the word out about this. This is our first one. And we plan on trying to have more, maybe an annual event or something. So we're excited about that. I have a suitcase up here. You'll understand why in just a little bit, because it's my title is Mannequins. You may have seen I put it on right at the end, right about an hour or two before service on Facebook. But it's Mannequins, Masks, and Masterpieces. And that's what my title is tonight. And I really think that God's just going to minister to us, and we're just going to do some real talk here tonight, because that's the only kind of talk I like. I don't like being fake. I don't want to be fake. I'm tired of being fake. And so most of you who have heard me speak or talk to me know that I pretty much just say whatever I'm doing, and because that's the only way I know to be now, because I'm tired of hiding. So we're just going to do real talk tonight and get down to business. But what I want to do, I wish I could do it live for you guys, But what I want to do is I want to play a song for you guys. You may have heard it before. It's by Tamela Mann, and she is the one who played in all of the Tyler Perry movies. She would sing, and she's Cora on there. That's who she is. That's her stage name. She has a CD, and this is her newest project, and there's a song called Take Me to the King, and it is the most powerful song. Like, I want to sing it, which I wouldn't be able to do close to what she does, but I want to play it and just listen to the words of it and just worship if you feel like it. Let them sink in and seep into your soul and your spirit, because it says, take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. I just have a lot of broken pieces. And but here's my offering, is what she says. And she said, I'm tired of playing games, tired of playing church. Just take me to the King. And it's my heart cry. Like, that is what I feel so deep. And I think it's what every woman feels. I think it's what every person really feels if we would strip everything away, is just take me to Him. I'm safe with Him. I might not be safe with you. You might not be safe with me, but just, I'm just going to bear it all. And God, here I am. And just take me. I'm broken. And put me back together the right way. So I just want to play it, and let's just listen to it and let the words minister to you, and then we'll get to the lesson right after it. But it's Take Me to the King.
Take me to the King. I don't have much to bring. My heart is torn in pieces. It's my offering. Take me to the King. Truth is, I'm tired. Options are few. I'm trying to pray, but where are you? I'm all churched out, hurt and abused. I can't fake what's left to do. Come, truth is, I'm weak, no strength to fight, no tears to cry, even if I tried, but still my soul refuses to die. Mm-hmm. One touch will change my life. Take me to the King. Don't have much to bring. My heart's torn in pieces. It's my offering. Lay me at the throne. Leave me there alone to gaze upon your glory and sing to you this song. Please take me to the King. Truth is, it's time to stop playing these games. We need a word for the people's pain. No rules, no release. bring. My heart's torn to pieces. It's my offering.
Isn't it beautiful? I love it. I just want to like when I pray it, it's just like, because I know what it feels like, and I know you do too. Because if you've taken one breath on planet Earth, you know what it's like to have your heart shredded to pieces. You know what it feels like. And let's just ask him to meet with us here. Let's just pray together before we begin. God, I thank you so much. Lord, I love you. God, we come before you. You are our King. You are our Heavenly Father. God, I thank you for every lady that's here, God. I ask that you would bless them just in a supernatural way like only you can, God. That we would bring you all of our pain, God, all of our fears, Lord, all of our failures and weaknesses, God. That we would bring everything to you tonight and we would lay it at your feet, God. That we could just get alone with you, that we could seek you. God, we come before you tonight, God, asking that you would just have your will and your way here tonight, God. Because I can't do anything, I can't say anything unless you anoint me, God. I ask that you would just anoint my words and let me speak what you would have me to say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, Mariah's going to help me up here. And we're going to talk about mannequins first. And most of you know if you've brought my suitcase up here, because I have some stuff in here, some wardrobe changing. And I don't have one of those, Mariah, unzip that, please. I unzipped the wrong thing. I don't have one of the, like, the little mannequin, like, bodice things, you know. That's what I wanted. And then I was like, well, I'll just use Mariah, you know, because she's going to be our mannequin tonight. And, you know, most of the time, if you come to any of my Bible studies or a lot of the blogs that I write or whatever, a lot of times they come from my journal. And I will journal about things, and then God ends up using them and turning them into a Bible study or a lesson. And I actually wrote this. I date everything so I can go back and see when I wrote it. And I wrote this in May 17th of this year, and didn't know why. I'll just have this thought, you know, and I'll start writing. And this is all very new to me. And so I wrote it, and I wrote down mannequins, masks, and masterpieces. And I started writing about mannequins. And, you know, if you see them in the stores or whatever, they're dressed up. They may have on a lot of different colors. And I wrote, others dress them up to showcase what they think that they should look like. They put them in their favorite colors and their preferred style. But who does the mannequin want to be? You were never created to be dressed in someone else's image. And I'm going to read some more of it as we go. But as I began to like study and felt God like move me in this direction, it's still so amazing to me how he does that. And I'll be like, God, what do you want me to teach? Or what do you want? And then I'll start reading in here and he wants me to do something I wrote back in May. And I'm like, what? You know, it's so cool. Like he's so awesome. And so what I want to do is we're going to pretend that Mariah is our mannequin, like in a store or anything else. And we're not created to be mannequins. Mannequins don't have a voice. Mannequins can't speak. Mannequins can't move unless somebody else moves them where they want them to go. And I know very well what it's like to be a mannequin because I was once a mannequin. And most of you probably were a mannequin. You may still be a mannequin, and you'll have to be honest with yourself before we leave tonight, whether you are or not. I haven't been long. It hasn't been long since I was. And I couldn't have a thought. I didn't even know what my own voice sounded like because I couldn't have an opinion about anything from the very smallest detail of my life to the largest one. It didn't matter. My opinion didn't matter. And, you know, my dad was definitely of this old school thought that children are to be seen and not heard. And so I absolutely didn't know who I was. And around getting close to 30 years old, I had like this like awakening happen, and everybody else thought I was going crazy, and I did kind of. And I just like swung the pendulum from one to the other, because trying to figure out, who am I? What do I like to do? I remember every friend that I would have, whatever their favorite color was my favorite color. Whatever car they wanted was what kind of car I wanted. Whatever they wanted to be when they got older is what I wanted to be, because I didn't know how to think for myself. I didn't know what I liked. I didn't know what kind of music I liked. I mean, it about drove Byron crazy. I started listening to everything. I mean, like, just everything I could, no matter what, from one spectrum to the other. I've listened to it. I just listened to everything. I mean, trying to figure out, though, who I was. But let's just talk about some of the clothes that people will put on a mannequin, and just see if maybe some of it makes sense to you. Sometimes I wish that I might have to put this down from time to time. Let's first, I'm going to put our shoes on. And our mannequin's going to have to move a little bit to help me, so just ignore that because I can't put this mic down. So sometimes because of, you know, the way we're raised or whatever, sometimes you have to, you know, they'll put on some shoes on us, and maybe some shoes of strife, because that's all we're used to. Yes, please. This is perfect. He's helping with inventory. Some shoes of strife. I know what that's like, because that my home was very unstable, you know, and it's the only kind of shoes I really knew, and wasn't accustomed to shoes of peace that the Bible talks about, for sure. You know, I wasn't accustomed to that. And sometimes they just put these scarves and just I didn't even like that color, but just have to wear it because that's what they said we should wear. And then maybe sometimes the coat of indifference, just you end up not caring about anything, not just one way or the other. You just start not really having an opinion because you don't really know what you think anyway. So isn't this looking nice? So I wonder, do you like it? Yes, you do? Yeah. Yeah, and sometimes, you know, let's see. All right. Yeah, I don't really like afros, but very much. I didn't think it was really my style, but I really didn't know how to fix my hair. I had naturally curly hair, and I would brush it out, and it was like so frizzy. And I didn't have product or anything, you know. I didn't know what to do with it. Hideous. I'm serious. But I didn't know how to fix it, you know. And so it's kind of like this. And our mannequin, you know, it's just the way that other people say we should look, and what their ideas are of looking good and pretty and what's acceptable. And so that's what I wore. And we can't, you know, most of these things look like women's stuff, but I don't know where you'll put this for sure. But also sometimes maybe get your father's handkerchief of hatred, and maybe just stuff it somewhere. Yeah, you just hold it. Yeah, because, yeah, usually I did. I just wave it around when I wanted to. And it's kind of subtle sometimes, but if that's how you've been dealt with, and we are a product of our environment and things that happen to us. And I think that probably, you know, also, even though, because, like, my dad was real proud, and, you know, he was in the church. And so kind of sometimes we wear hats of haughtiness. And we have our mannequin all fixed up. And, you know, it doesn't look like the stuff really fits her so well, right? But it's what I said she should wear. So I mean, that she has to wear it, right? I mean, it's what I said she should wear. It's what people say that you should wear. It's what society says you should be and look like. It's what maybe even a spouse or family member expects you to be, and you live up to the expectations of what everybody else wants you to be, all the while not knowing who you are, not knowing what you like, what music, what is your heart song, not knowing any of it, not knowing any of it at all. I wrote that many of us are mannequins in store windows on display for the world, clad in brightly vibrant colors and silky, showy fabrics, fabrics of falsehood draped upon us by often well-meaning designers trying to get ahead or trying to reproduce a replica of their vision. And that's an excerpt from our journal. So let's thank Mariah for being our mannequin. We're going to move on to masks now that we wear. If you, no, she can take it off. Thank you, Mariah. Good sport. And honestly, it looks so much like me, seriously. Like, I mean, I didn't, I'll use it. Thank you. I really didn't know. I really didn't know what I like. I didn't even know what, she still has the shoes of, she still has on her boots of bitterness or shoes of strife. Yeah, those are supposed to be removed. Messing up my object lesson. But it's just something that we simply wear. It's something that somebody else generally puts on you. Because a mannequin doesn't put stuff on themselves. But then there comes a point that we have to, because we're not mannequins. It's like a mannequin syndrome that God kind of dealt with me about. I don't know if it's really such a thing. But it's just somebody else puts it on you. All through the Bible, I often wondered why he would talk about these behaviors and like love, the gifts of the Spirit and things. He would actually say to put them on. And I often wondered why. And even the armor of God, he said to put it on. But it's decisions we make. It's behaviors that we have to actually put on. And a lot of times you don't feel it at first. Because you have to do it out of knowledge. You have to do it because you know it's the right thing. That's why we must know what God's word says about what we're to look like, about that we're created in his image and that we can have an opinion and we can like certain things and not like certain things and that we're all different for a reason. But there really is a spirit that attacks people, not just the church, just people in general, that if somebody's not exactly like me, then I don't accept them. If they don't like what I like and they don't like the same kind of music or they don't like to dress like I dress or if they don't like, you know, if we don't just get along, and you're always going to have people that you meshed with more than others. That's normal. Jesus had closer disciples in his group than others. And that's fine. But I'm talking about this isolation that you don't ever feel like you can accept anybody or we don't let people in that are different than we are. And oftentimes we try to morph to be like everybody else just to be accepted. And I lived the majority of my life so far like that. And it is not God's will for us to do that. You were never created to be dressed in someone else's image because you were made and created and formed in the image of God. And he created every one of us. You can look through this room at the different features and the difference in our just our physical appearance and see that we serve a God of variety. It's okay if you don't like what I like. It's okay if you don't think like I think. It's okay if your strengths are different than my strengths. Do you know, I used to like think that if I wasn't good in a certain area, and this is real new too because it wasn't that long ago, I would beat myself up and feel so bad about myself for what I was not good at because I felt like that I had to be good at everything. And if I wasn't, then something was wrong with me and I was flawed, not realizing that he doesn't put all the same strengths in any one person because we would get a big head. He puts that, the reason he leaves that area is so he can use you in that area and so that you'll need somebody else to help you in that area. So you won't ever get self-sufficient and just think that you're it, or I will think that I'm it. He does that on purpose, but I didn't know that. I didn't know that. I didn't know that that was okay, and I'm learning that that's okay. I'm not going to actually put this all the way on just because I would have to tie it, but I wanted just to find one of those little masquerade-like things, but this is just a mask. I was going to put it on my whole thing, but I'm not going to, but you get the point. But I want to talk about some of the masks that we wear. Because mannequins, it's stuff that's imposed on us. It's stuff that other people put on us. Masks, we put on ourselves. We put on ourselves because we choose to wear these to assume an identity of our choosing. Now, sometimes it's still what we think somebody else expects us to be. When I got married, I thought, because that's all I ever knew was performance-based love. And whenever I got married, I tried to be the best boyfriend Byron ever had. I mean, I tried to be a man. I didn't know that's what I was doing, but I really did. I mean, I learned how to play NFL Blitz on PlayStation. I didn't know the last thing about the football. I mean, nothing. I learned how to play it. I can tell you the moves and stuff. I mean, I would juke. I know all those terms because I learned to do it. We played Tiger Woods golf on the PlayStation for hours. I was every weekend at a softball tournament. Had Isaac. I think Isaac was like 2 months old, and I had him at a softball tournament out in the heat, out there supporting Byron, you know. And I mean, I would talk and let them be so sarcastic and talk to me, and I would talk back to them the same way. And, you know, like, I didn't really like it, but I thought it was what I was supposed to do. And I even pretended to like it. I didn't realize that I didn't like it. And I mean, he was in for a rude awakening whenever, you know, I started like this awakening time, because he lost his boyfriend, you know, and I had to let him know I'm a girl, you know? And so it was like, he had the best of both worlds, because I just did everything he wanted me to do. And I mean, he was nice to me. He wasn't rude to me or mean. It was nothing like that. But this is the thing. If you'll wear a mask for somebody, and you'll change them and wear them in order to please them, and you're not true to who you are, they'll let you, and they will enjoy it, because who wouldn't? I would too. If you do everything I like, yeah, I mean, I'm gonna like that, but you're gonna be dying inside. It's not gonna work out. It's not gonna work out so well for you. We wear them to hide. We wear them to blend. We wear them to stand out, and sometimes we wear them because we think they'll make us win. We must, you know, this is like not old. I mean, this is like the oldest thing in the book. This started in the Garden of Eden. Whenever they sinned, and whenever they wanted to hide from God, and whenever they were going to be, they designed themselves. They got these fig leaves, and it was what they had contrived, and they tried to hide behind it. And we're going to have to strip that away. I don't know what your fig leaf is. I don't know. Because God covered them. The Bible says that God covered them with skin after he removed what they had contrived on their own and wore. They had, you know, fixed that together to try to hide from him. And really, whenever we hide like that and we wear those masks, we're not honest with God either. We're not honest with ourselves. We're not honest with other people. And when we do that, our inside, we're lying, we're living a lie on the inside. And we have to be true to who we are and who God created you to be. And I'm not talking about an excuse like the New Age movement. I'm not talking about an excuse to be just whatever in the world we want to be. I'm talking about lining up with the Word of God, pleasing God, not sinning, living like He wants us to live, but being who you are. You're an original. You're a one of a kind. And the masks that we hide behind are, I mean, it would take forever to go through all of those. But I did want to read you a quote by his name's Andre. I don't know how to pronounce the last name, Berthame, I think, but I'm not sure. He said, "We all wear masks, and the time comes when we cannot remove them without removing some of our own skin." And I thought, that is so, so powerful. And oftentimes, like, depending on the layers of the mask that we have, I'm still trying to pull off masks to figure out what I like and you know, what my life is really about. But we really don't sometimes even know we're wearing them until we ask the Holy Spirit to reveal. And we get really real and sit down and like, God, show me if I am deceived. Show me if I'm not really being who I really am. Because I can't tell you, I really like I like fashion. I'm not a big shopper, but I really do like clothes, and I have my own like kind of style thing going on or whatever. You know, I know what I like when I see it or whatever, and nobody else, you know, they might not even like it. But kind of for a long time, that became my identity, because I was like, I just want to try to like look the part, you know, like then people will, they won't see the abused person underneath it. And I will look like I have it all together, and I'll look, you know, like my clothes match. She's fashionable, and that was kind of like my thing. But they mask never last. They never last, because you're like putting them on and taking them off, and putting them on and taking them off, and putting another one on for another person, because it's just one lie after another when you wear those, and you're deceiving other people. And every one of us, because we're human, we can't keep up the act always, and it ends up shattering and falling at our feet. And then the people that we were wearing the mask to try to please end up getting mad at us and upset, because they were in love with the mask, not you. And they only saw the facade that we put forth, and then when it's gone, they're not loyal to who you really are, because you never showed them who you really were. And just by the grace of God, you know, I'm still married. And if somebody really does love you, and I mean, Byron, we've had to do the same thing. It's part of growing, anybody, because we're all going to be changed. We all evolve. We really do. And the older we get, the more we learn. And people who love you will love you, and people who love you will be there for you, in those times. But, I mean, I really thought, I was like, what in the world? Nobody loved me. Because whenever I quit the act, they all left. And I didn't know what to do. And they thought I was going crazy. And just rest assured, if you decide to deal in truth, you'll have that time of everybody kind of going crazy and thinking you're crazy. If you will hold on, though, it will come back around, and God will, if you'll do it with Him and do it His way. He is with you. He understands, and He helps to pull you through it, to get you to who you really are, to knowing who you are in Christ. There's no confidence like realizing I'm really one of His. I really am a child of God, and I'm special without all the junk. I almost said it. But anyway, and I guess I say that, so anyway. But I mean, he loves me anyway. He loves me in spite of me. Do you know He is not the least bit surprised at your weaknesses? He put them there. He designed you with that flaw so that you would need Him. It's the most freeing thing in the whole world, is to realize that my weakness is actually the key that opens God's strength. That's powerful. He said His strength is made perfect in your weakness. And we're all the time trying to cover those up. We're all the time trying to hide. I'm trying to hide mine from you, and you're trying to hide it from me. And I don't want somebody to know that I'm not good in a certain area. None of us are. And actually, I don't think that we would be hurting as much as we are if we would quit pretending. And we would just say, look, I need prayer. There was a Sunday morning about 2 months ago, I was like a wreck by the time I got here on Sunday morning. And you know, like there was a time when I would have, you know, gone to the restroom and I would have put a smile on my face and I would have acted like nothing was wrong. And I would have gotten up here, and I mean, I can't tell you the stuff I've led worship through the years. But I went and I got Karen and I got Tanya and I said, you know what? I'm having a horrible day. Things are just like going to pot right now in my life. I need y'all to pray for me. And do you know, I felt strength. I felt a surge of strength and I got up here and I didn't have, if I wouldn't have done it and I would have gotten up here, it would have been unnecessary, because that's what the body of Christ is for. And we're supposed to be there for one another. And so I hope that you will take your masks off. I hope that you will just, and you know, that's much easier said than done, because trust me, some skin's going to come off. But much better skin grows back. Anybody who's ever had a burn or anything like that, baby skin grows back, and it's soft and it's healthy. And when it grows back, it'll be who you really are. And it'll hurt. Some stuff will come off. Because even now I'm going through some tearing away time right now that God is making me and forming me. But it's worth it. Because even in the midst of it, I feel more free than I've ever felt in my whole life. And there are times when I cry and it hurts. It hurts so bad. But it's like the best of times and the worst of times. like that poem. And it's just because God is with you in the midst of it and you realize that it's a necessary process. That's why he said that, that's why Paul said in the New Testament that when I don't really live until I die. I die that I may live. And that's what we have to do because our flesh is what dies. And the real you is the spirit he placed inside of you. Because he put this flesh, we just had to have a body to put it in. God had to form a body around the real you. But the body is what all the mess happens to. And the body and the motions is what all the family stuff happens to. And the environment that you're raised in and the abuse. It affects your emotions and it affects your flesh, your body. But your spirit inside is who you really are. And the only way you're going to find out who that person really is to let your flesh die. And to say, God, reveal to me what I'm covering up with. Reveal to me what my fig leaf is. And do you know, he covered them with skin after he removed what they had contrived. And when you remove what you've contrived and ask God to show you, and if you do, he will. If you get serious with him and you ask him to, he'll begin to show you. And you sometimes will not like what he shows you. And when he first showed me in the first phase of my, I call it my demolition, I cried for 3 days and I was like, wow, you know, I really was. I mean, I was a total bit behind to Byron. I mean, the way I was doing, it was just like, I don't even know. I wouldn't have liked myself. And I was trying to work through my stuff, but I had allowed myself to get bitter and hard and I took it out on everybody else and it was everybody else's fault. And God had to deal with me about taking the mask off because we wear all different kinds. Some people wear masks and are just really, really funny when they are dying inside. They make jokes constantly, but when they go to bed at night, they weep and they cry. And a lot of times the most comedic people, they are very lonely, isolated, and when they lay down, they cry because nobody makes them laugh. And it's a mask that people wear. We all have these masks that we put up, these faces. And God wants us to tear them down because whenever you will allow yourself to get transparent before him, he can start healing. Because you can never change what you're not willing to confront. Never. And you can't confront it unless you get honest with God about it. And that's why he said, ask and you shall receive. You're not going to be able to ask him for something that you don't even realize and you're not honest with yourself about. That's why now I bear it all to him. I'm like, I'm doing bad things. You know, I'm like, I mean, I tell him exactly what it is. And I'm just honest with him. And now I'm so happy because I don't know why I don't know why we think we can hide it from him anyway. He already knows. We're not telling him for his benefit. We're telling him for ours so that we will say it and be honest. And you and I have to quit judging one another for the fact that we do have those issues. You know, I mean, I'm starting to realize that nobody's any different. The Bible said there's nothing new under the sun. There really isn't. But especially in church circles, we have gotten judgmental without realizing it. It's very subtle because your brand of dysfunction is different than my brand of dysfunction, then you're wrong. It doesn't work that way. We all have different brands, but they're all dysfunction. We all have weaknesses. We all have areas. And if we would really realize that, that's how we can love people. That's why he said, while you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. He died and he said, Father, forgive them, when nobody even asked him for forgiveness. And he's our example. And I'm starting to realize it now because we get so angry at people when our battle's not with people. Our battle is with the enemy. And I've done the same thing. I get so angry at people in my life who've done things, and I'm not saying that they're not wrong. They are. They are. It's not right. And it's hard, but what the devil wants you to do is fight them instead of praying for them and working on yourself, Because while we are looking and saying something to somebody else, we have the same stuff going on in our own heart. The same stuff. And so we need to ditch the mask. I'm going to read you a little piece out of my journal on mask that I wrote. We all wear them. There are many different kinds. The reason we wear them is the conflict between who we are or who we think we are and who God really says that we are supposed to be. You are an original. God has a specific plan for your life. It is tailor-made, cut to the precise measurement of your destiny. Everything that you've gone through, it's not wasted. Every pain, every problem, every tear you've cried, every situation and circumstance that you think is unfair, somehow, in His sovereignty, we can't fathom it, we can't wrap our brains around it, but He uses all of it to create our destiny and our purpose and what we're supposed to be. And if we could just see that on the other side of it, that there's something beautiful that He's really going to do with the pain. There's purpose that you can find in your pain. I lived most of my life being very bitter about the things that happened to me in my life and not understanding why and what I had done to deserve it. But at the end of the day, what God is like showing me now is there's purpose in it. There's purpose in my pain. And that if I'll push through it and if I'll trust Him, that He really is going to make something beautiful out of it. He really is. Because He has a purpose and plan for every single one of you. I want to read out of the Message before I get to masterpieces, and it leads us right into it. I want to read it out of the Message Bible. It's so beautiful. It's Psalm 139, if you want to turn to it, 13 through 16. And this is David, and it's the most beautiful psalm as he's talking to God about knowing that He formed him. It's beautiful in every version you want to read it in, but I want to read it to you out of the Message. Psalm 139, verses 13 through 16. Oh, yes, You shaped me first, inside, then out. You formed me in my mother's womb. I thank You, high God. You are breathtaking. Body and soul, I am marvelously made. I worship in adoration. What a creation. You know me inside and out. You know every bone in my body. You know exactly how I was made, bit by bit. How I was sculpted, and remember that word, sculpted. How I was sculpted from nothing into something. Like an open book, You watched me grow from conception to birth. All the stages of my life were spread out before You. The days of my life all prepared before I'd even lived one day. And I know sometimes that's very difficult to understand because I have asked the same questions that you're probably thinking in your mind right now. If a God is so gracious, then why does He allow me to go through this? Why would He allow this situation? Why would He allow this pain? And I don't have the answers for you. You may understand one day and you may not. But He is sovereign and God is perfect. And I have learned not to question Him. People will fail you. He will never, ever fail you. People will hurt you. He will never, ever hurt you. He only has your best interest at heart. He only says no for the sake of a greater yes. Always. Always. Because He has a perfect plan. And He didn't put us on this earth for the things that a lot of times that we think we are put on this earth for. We're put on this earth to make a difference. We're put on this earth to do something for Him, to be lights, to shine. And if we could ever get a grasp on exactly what He has for us and that we are to be His masterpiece. Could you just do like this? Just pinch your arm for me. Just say, I'm a piece of the Master. I'm the piece of the Master. He created you. He created you. The Bible said that Jesus was the stone that the builders rejected. And then it goes on to talk about that we're all stones that are fitting together to make up the body of Christ. And I just had this thought, and I mean no disrespect by it, but we're just chips off the old block. We're created in His image. That is special. That's awesome. That's who you are. You're His. He created you in His image. You're not junk. You're not an accident. With all your imperfections, with all your failures, with everything that you do, it doesn't surprise Him. Not one bit. Really, He just is ready for you to get honest with Him about it. It was like, I think it was 2 weeks ago, one day I went up to my office and I was like going to have my prayer time. Well, in the middle of it, I kind of pitched a fit. I was just like, I was frustrated at things that were happening. And I was like, I just kind of had one of those, you know, breakdowns in, I don't know if you've ever done that in your prayer time. It's just like, and I even said, you know, trying to make it real spiritual. I was like, just like Jacob did when he wrestled with that angel, I will not leave this prayer room. I will not leave this office until you make me feel better. I am not leaving out of here the same way. And I mean, I was crying and bawling in a mess on the floor too. I mean, I was really into it. And it's almost like God just was like, you know how you've all prayed those prayers and you've said stuff like that. And I literally did. I can't do anything about it. You're just going to have to take it. I just give up. I just give it to you. It's almost like He's happy. Really? Okay, good. Now I can do something. You know, and if we wouldn't have to get to that point and we would just realize that that's the point we're supposed to be at always, because whenever we're there, that's where we're supposed to be every single day, every single minute of every day. It's just like, God, I can't do anything. I can't do anything. But unfortunately, we like have to get to that, you know, like pity party stage where real dramatic. And I do. Sometimes I slide off the side of the Chase Lounge that's in there. Like, I really will. I'm like, I do not do anything. And I'll slide down. And you're going to have to help me. I can't do it anymore. And it's like, He's like, seriously? I mean, it's like, He's like, that's really where I want you to be. You can't ever do anything. Even when you think you can't. And so that, let's read. I want to read Ephesians 2 and verse 10. And then I'm going to tell you guys a story about Michelangelo's sculpture, David. I'm going to read out of the Amplified version. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10. For we are God's own handiwork, His workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined, planned beforehand for us, taking paths which He prepared ahead of time, that we should walk in them, living the good life which He prearranged and made ready for us to live. We are His own handiwork, His workmanship. And we read in Psalm 139 a few minutes ago that He sculpted us. And when I read that word sculpted, I was so excited because it fit perfectly into my message tonight. I want to talk to you just a minute about the master sculptor. But I want to talk to you about Michelangelo. And you've all heard of the sculpture of David. And what I didn't realize as I was reading about it was that Michelangelo wasn't the first one to sculpt out of that marble. There were two other sculptors who had actually worked on it and had given up. And it was like 26 years later when Michelangelo started the project. And I want to read to you a little bit of what it says. It says that it was a 19-foot block of marble, and that, you know, there were two other sculptors. And then 26 years later, Michelangelo, he was 26 years old at the time also, whenever he picked up his chisel and began to sculpt this rock. And sources say that the artist never left his David. For more than 2 years, he worked on and slept beside the 6-ton slab of marble whose subject called to him from inside the unchiseled places. When at last the 17-foot David emerged, Michelangelo is reported to have said, "I saw the angel in the marble and carved until I set him free." When asked how he made his statue, Michelangelo is reported to have said, "It is easy. You just chip away the stone that doesn't look like David." And this is what captivated me, though, as I was just reading, and it's not like a, that part's not from history, but if you go actually to see the sculpture, if you're walking down like this like aisle, like kind of an open like hallway area, and there's like a long line because that's what everybody wants to see, and so David is like in the distance, but as you're waiting in the line, on the edges, there are these unfinished sculptures. And whenever I was looking at, because I was like looking at pictures of it and all that, and I was thinking that I might show some pictures or whatever, and then I ended up not doing it. But they're unfinished. And like, why in the world would blocks of like roughly hewn stone that's unfinished or whatever catch my attention more than David? You know, but it really did. It captivated me. And it's a collection that's called, it's entitled Prisoners. And you can look it up if on the internet or whatever if you want to. And they're all along, like this wonderful completed masterpiece is up ahead. And then there's this collection called Prisoners along the way that it's unfinished. And none of them are finished. They're all just like partially completed blocks of marble. And I started thinking, because I think that it spoke to me so much, because I feel like one of those. And I think so often we all do. We feel like a block of marble that we're just kind of only have one arm, you know, or maybe a leg and an arm, but we're still incomplete. And we feel like we're in prison, and we feel like we're in bondage. And I think that's kind of what I thought was like, God, chisel me. I don't want to be locked in my hard places forever. I don't want to stay there longer than I have to. Because you have to give him permission. You have to allow him to chisel that stuff away from your life. You have to allow him to begin to finish the masterpiece that he has begun. You remember the scripture that says, "He who has begun a good work in you is faithful to finish it." He's the author and the finisher of our faith, but he is not under any obligation to finish anything that he didn't author. So we get stuck a lot of times when we're trying to write our own stories, or I guess chisel our own rocks. That's what captivated me more than anything. And you know what? I think that's what captivates God. Because he wants to finish. He wants to finish what he started in you. He wants to finish what he started in me. That's his plan all along. He doesn't want you to stay stuck. He doesn't want me to stay stuck. It really is. I am learning to love when God chisels me. It doesn't feel good. But when he deals with me, and as he strips layers off of my life, and it gets closer and closer to the real me, and I feel like I can actually say things that I think, and I feel like I can breathe. I feel like that I am actually emerging for the first time in my life, and like I've never lived before, you know? And you can too. We really can. We really can become all that God wants us to be. All we have to do is submit to his will. We have to allow him to do the work. We have to allow him to get that chisel and that hammer out and knock off some stuff that doesn't look like him. Just like Michelangelo said, he just had to chip away the stuff that didn't look like David. He has to break some of that stuff off, because we're created in his image. And we have a lot of stuff going on. A lot of times it doesn't look anything like him. That this life put on us, or that we put on ourselves to try to become what they wanted us to be. To try to be accepted, to try to be loved. I had tap dancing shoes on. I tap danced until I can't tap dance anymore. I have corns on my feet. I did everything that every person wanted me to do. I burn myself out working at churches, trying to please people. But that's the problem. We are not created to please people. We're created to please God. And whenever we put Him first and we seek Him first, and He is our everything, you want to be more like Him. It's not even a bad thing. It's like He loves you so much, and it's a good feeling to want to be like Him. And it's kind of like the pain of exercise. Whenever you do, it's like you're actually glad that you feel something, because it means that there's a muscle that's still in there. It's like, oh, okay, I did lunges a week ago, and to sit down on the toilet, I was like, oh my God. I had to hold on to the wall. It was like, I felt like this was going to explode. And I only did like 15. It was nothing. And that probably didn't even do them right. But I was happy, you know. I was like secretly proud of that pain, because that meant that it did something. I worked it. I could feel it. It's the same thing when we have pain in our spirit. Whenever we do something and God starts chiseling away, and we exercise our faith muscles, or we have to be patient in a trial, or we have to love somebody that's acting very unlovable, or we're growing those spiritual muscles. And the fact that you feel that pain means that there's still some good working spiritual muscles in there. And you're working them, and you're getting stronger. And, you know, we could all be set so free if we would just realize, we begin to accept ourselves, and we would begin to accept other people, because we are human and we are flawed, and we will hurt one another. We'll say things we shouldn't. We just will. We're people. It's this Adamic nature. But He died for us. He's patient with us. He forgives us. And He expects us to do it for others. So much so that every commandment that He gave us is only for actually to unlock a greater yes, because He said, forgive others so that I can forgive you. He doesn't ever tell us to do something just to do it. He tells us, and it unlocks His favor and His blessings in our life. It's always for a reason. So I want to invite you tonight to join me on a journey of imperfect progress. The reason that we do all this stuff and all contrive all these masks and all this stuff is because we really feel like that we can't get it perfect. And so we end up not doing anything because we're afraid of not being perfect. We're afraid of people seeing that we're going to mess up, or we're afraid that if we start that plan, that diet, or if we start that that emotional, you know, roller coaster of trying to strip away that stuff, and we're afraid that we're going to hurt, and we're afraid that we're actually going to fail. And so then we don't end up making any forward progress. And what I read a book recently, and some of that was in there, but also as God began to deal with me, I know what it's like to praise God 1 minute and yell at my kid the next and bite their head off. You know, I know what it's like to have the best intentions and then not do what I wanted to do. And we all do. We all do. But we can just make imperfect progress. You're not going to be perfect until you stand before Him. Until we have our heavenly bodies, we're not. We're just not. And He's okay with that. He just wants us to get honest where we're at. And if it's just this much, rejoice in that. If you just don't talk about somebody for one day, if that's your thing, then ask God and tell Him, celebrate it. Be thankful. Don't be mad at yourself because you mess up once whenever you've had 5 days of doing great. Just get back up and keep going. When I fall, I shall. Rejoice not against me, O mine enemy. When I fall, I shall arise. That's all that matters. Just keep pushing forward. Just keep going forward. You don't have to be perfect. Just start somewhere. Just ask God where He wants you to start and start there. And know that you cannot do it without the help of God. Absolutely not. Cry out to God for His anointing and His help to do whatever it is that you're going to try to do. I've learned that because I got so frustrated every time I would try. I was determined to change and not be emotional and not gripe and not be a nag and not, I mean, and it never works. You can have the best intentions and it'll last for a little bit and then you will not be able to keep it up. You have to ask for God to help you because He said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And so I've learned now, I don't even pretend. I get up in the morning and go up there because if I don't have my prayer time, I really am a brat. And like, I do not act right. I really cut up. And I can see it now. I used to think it was everybody else. It's not. I thought I was okay. No. I've learned now everybody gets on my nerves. And the older I get, it's worse. It's worse. It's worse. And so now I go up there. I mean, one of the first things I say is, I'm going to go out of here and I'm going to screw everything up if you don't help me. I'm going to mess up. I'm going to hurt people's feelings. I'm going to say things I shouldn't. I need you to help me. The most powerful prayer you can pray is help me. Just help me. And I do it all during the day. And He will. He just wants you to ask. And so I wanted to teach this tonight because I think that sometimes that we girls tend to think that if we don't make instant progress, that change isn't coming, and that's not true. And so I think that it will set us up for this whole semester. We're going to be talking about faith, and next on the 19th, I'm going to teach Why Does Our Faith Fail? And I'm excited about it because it's awesome, and I wanted to do it tonight, and God said no. And so I'm going to do that on the 19th if He says yes. And so, but I want to, this is actually perfect because it sets us up because we'll be doing a different study over there. We're going to study Gideon, I think, but I'm excited because this is exactly what we have to do. We're going to make progress together. We're going to talk about a lot of different things. We're going to talk about our faith. We're going to talk about our tongues. We're going to talk about our thoughts. We're going to talk about our relationships. We're going to talk about some things that God's shown me about how it's harder to start at home, but that's where it starts. And like some things that God's been dealing with me about, and we're going to deal with some tough issues, and we're going to just do real talk with one another. But we're going to make imperfect progress. And so you will fall, and you will make mistakes. I will too. But that's why He called us. That's all part of it. Your weakness is your greatest strength in Him. You don't have to be worried about it. Just give it to Him. That's not a license to sin. It's not a license to be rude. It's just a license to accept who you are. Because if God doesn't change you, you're not going to change anyway. That's the truth. And so He wants you just to get okay with it. And next week we're going to talk about, or the week after that, we're going to talk about Peter and the great contradiction between Peter's great fear and Peter's great faith. And we're going to talk about the contradictions in our lives and how God is not worried about it one bit. Why don't you just stand with me and let's pray before we leave? And I hope that you're encouraged. I hope that you will go home and ask God to show you your mask or masks. It's kind of hard to say that one. And I believe we all have some, actually, because I believe that we're always deceived in some area of our life. And I believe that God just reveals to us what we can handle at the time. And then we deal with that, and then He'll bring what we can handle the next time. That's why I have to be patient with one another. Because just because you graduated and I graduated doesn't mean we have to burn down the school. Because everybody's at a different stage and a level. And we have to be patient with one another and love one another. And let's pray for one another, you know? And if something's going on, email or text me or any of us. Like, you know, let's be there for one another. Let's encourage one another. And I pray for you guys. I write it down so that I always pray that God would open the eyes of your understanding. And I pray that His love would be shed abroad in your life and spill over into every part of your family, your finances. Those are things I pray every time that I pray because I'm trying to pray the prayers that God asked Paul to pray for the church. And so I don't know your individual needs, but when you have them, tell us. Because prayer works, I can tell you. I prayed months ago for my hairdresser. I didn't even know because she told me about this problem, and I didn't tell her I was praying for her. I went back to talk to her, and it had been months. And she told me, she said, we bought a house. And, you know, she was telling me this stuff. And she actually lives now like 2 miles from me. And I didn't even know it. And she said, we started going to a church. They hadn't gone to church the whole time she'd ever been married, and they've been married for 12 years. She started telling me all this stuff. And I'm thinking to myself, God, I prayed that, and kind of half-heartedly. You know, I just prayed for her. Prayer works. Prayer works. And I really think we don't ask. That's what God's been dealing with me about, is sometimes you think things, you're going through things, but you don't tell me. It's kind of like our husbands. They don't tell us. You know, if you ever call Byron and tell him anything, I don't know, but I can promise you, because he will not tell me. You're going to have to come tell me. Well, it's kind of the same way. We think, and we think that God just knows, and he does know, but we have to tell him. We have to ask him. So whatever you need, begin to ask him for it. Begin to accept your weakness and say, right there, I'm weak. I'm sorry at that. I don't do good at it. Help me. I need you to help me, because I'm not going to do good at it if you don't help me. And that's what I've started doing, and it works. I mean, who would know? Who would think that the Bible works? I mean, this really works. Who knew? It does. It's powerful. And so begin to just, like, believe in yourself. Just don't, if you are still in a mannequin stage, don't stay there. Don't let somebody else dress you and make you look the way they want you to look and the way they want you to think. Ask God to show you your mask and put them up. Put them up, even if it hurts when you rip them off. If God helps you and you'll ask him to help you, he really softens the blow. He really does. And the pain of progress is always better than the pain of procrastination. So just seek him and push forward and be encouraged, because you're awesome. He created you. He formed you. He knew you. He had a perfect plan before the beginning of time. And what we can't see, Michelangelo saw David before he ever chiseled him out. He saw it in his mind's eye. God already sees you as a finished product. He already sees me as a finished product. And that's why it doesn't make sense to us what we're going through, but it does to him, because he knows just the right buttons to allow people to push in situations. They're going to make us hit our knees and knock off a piece of that doesn't look like him. He knows exactly what to do. He does. And he's working it all out, and it's going to be okay. You know, sometimes that to me is the best thing to say, because it's the truth. It's going to be okay. And I feel that in my spirit tonight, just to tell you that whatever you're going through right now, it's going to be okay. It really is. It really is. He knows, and he has it. And he's there for you, and he's proud of you. He's proud of you. He's not mad at you. Joyce Meyer just wrote a book, and it's coming out soon. God is not mad at you. I think we all kind of walk around thinking that. And so maybe you can leave tonight knowing that you're okay. You're okay. He loves you. If we love our kids like we do, even when they do the jacked up stuff they do sometimes, where do you think you got that emotion? You got that emotion from God, because you're created in his image. Your heavenly Father is not mad at you. He loves you. He does want us to do better, but he loves you, and he'll be patient with you until you get it. He'll always be right there. He'll always be right there. So I just pray tonight that you feel his arms wrapped around you. God, I ask right now that you would just saturate these women with your love. Would you just wrap your awesome, huge arms, all-encompassing, loving arms about them, God. Lord, I thank you for your sweet presence that I feel here tonight, God. I thank you, Lord, for healing, emotional healing, physical healing, God. Lord, that as we seek you, God, as we just try to press forward, God, to fall into you, God, that they would accept their weaknesses and realize that that is exactly the area that you want to show off in. That's exactly the key that unlocks your strength, God. I ask that you would speak peace to every troubled soul, God, every troubled spirit, Lord. God, I pray right now, I speak peace be still in the name of Jesus. I come against any spirit of chaos, God. And I rebuke it in Jesus' name. And I loose your perfect peace, God. Your peace that passes all understanding, God. I ask that you would open the eyes of their understanding, that you would bless their homes, God, their families, God, heal their emotions, God. Let them know that you are right there. Let them be so aware of your presence, God. Let them feel you in such a powerful and a mighty and a strong way, God. Help them to know that you are near, God. Help them to cry out to you and ask you for what they need and not to just settle and just wallow in their pain, God, but to cry out to you, God, because you are always there. You're an ever-present help in the time of trouble. God, let them know that they are special and loved, God, and help them to remove every falsity, every mask, God, anything that they have contrived, Lord. I ask that you would just strip us, God, and that we would just stand transparent before you, God. That way you can heal us, God. Change us, make us more like you, God. Make us into the masterpieces that you planned from the beginning of time for us to be. And I ask that you would help them to have a wonderful rest of this week, God, and just let your blessings be upon them, God, and let your face shine upon them, God. We give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. We lift you up and we magnify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much. Thank y'all for coming. I love y'all so much, and I really do pray for y'all, and y'all pray for me, because I don't know what I'm, can say to y'all, but I really am thankful that y'all came.